Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Father, we come before you, and Lord, we're just so grateful for the opportunity to be here. Lord, thank you for this house. Thank you for the opportunity that we have to gather together with brothers and sisters in the faith, of like faith, that we can join together and we can worship you, Lord. We don't come here for tradition. We don't come here for ritual. We don't come here to hear from a man, from the old or from the young, Lord. We come to hear from you, and we acknowledge that at this church, we see Jesus as our senior leader. And Lord, in the name of Jesus, we ask today that it wouldn't be the Reader's Digest suggestions of a man, but Lord, it would be the leading of the Holy Spirit that teaches us, that moves us and motivates us and directs us out of your word to be who you've called us to be and to show us your word, Lord, your ideas and your precepts and your will for our lives. And Lord, we thank you that you would bless us in this house today as we follow after you. Thank you for all that you've blessed us with here at this church, Lord. We don't see ourselves as better than anybody else or higher, but Lord, we thank you that you would bless all the churches across the Inland Empire that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ today. Lord, we see ourselves as brothers and sisters working together to build your kingdom. So Lord, with that, we ask that you bless our Catholic brothers and sisters and our Adventist brothers and sisters, the Calvary chapels of the area, Lord. We ask that you would fall upon them. Lord, we thank you for all the churches that belong to denominations that declare Jesus as Lord. Lord, we thank you that we're brothers and sisters to them. Father, we ask that you would bless churches that are local, like Harvest, and churches like Sandals and The Grove. Lord, we thank you for Water of Life and Ecclesia, Emmanuel Baptist. Lord, we ask that you'd bless New Creation and Oak Valley, Abundant Living. Lord, we know we can't reach this Inland Empire all by ourselves. And Lord, we are all members of the team, the body of Christ, working together to build your kingdom for your glory. So Father, bless them as you have blessed us. Speak to them as we ask you speak to us today. And Lord, to you be the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said, amen. Amen. Well, as we prepare to get into the Word of God, why don't you grab your Bibles, get your Bibles out, and go with me to the book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 11. If you don't have a Bible, the church is the greatest place to start bringing a Bible. Like, if you don't know, like, bring a Bible to church, really good idea. You can get one on your phone or your tablet as well. You can turn there to Hebrews chapter 11. Now, if you're just joining us, we always go line upon line, precept upon precept, and we've been in the book of Hebrews for quite some time. I mean, literally moving at a glacial pace. 5 years, and we've got ourselves here at Hebrews chapter 11. Lots of good truths, and I'm excited for what God's got in store for us today. Today, I want to talk to you. The title of this afternoon is simply this: dealing with our truth issues. Dealing with trust issues, not truth issues. Dealing with our trust issues. I remember a couple of years ago, we started doing this thing with our interns. Every year we have a group of interns that comes and they give of their time and they serve in the body of Christ and the various ministries, interns in our children's ministry and our youth ministry, our young adults ministry, and here in the office and the women's ministry. We have a group of interns every year that come together and they give of their time. And when they start their internship, we always go on this thing called an internship advance, where we go out and they do trust building exercises and team building exercises, and they learn to put their faith in God, and then they work through issues together and they learn how to work as a team, and the leaders come and we sow into them and we just have a good time. And one of the biggest parts of the internship advance is this thing we call a trust fall. A trust fall is simply where you go up on a ledge or something higher than everybody else. In the case of the intern advance, we have this ladder that's about 5 feet tall, and they climb to the very top of the ladder. And at the top of the ladder, they have to look to everybody that are standing on the top ledge of this ladder, and they're looking to all the other interns and all their other team members. And they have to tell them what they expect God to do in their lives, what they're going to leave behind that's been holding them back, and what they're going to trust God to help them move through and move past. And as they do, they turn around and they put their hands over their chest, and then they fall back about 5 or 6 feet, and they trust that their team will catch them. As a matter of fact, to exemplify to them that the team will catch them, we do it every year. The pastors as well do it. So I have a little video. I filmed myself doing a trust fall, so I think they have a video for it. Check it out.
Ready? All right, catchers, ready?
Oh my God! Ready.
Falling.
Fall on.
The girls.
The very first time I did it, I was terrified of heights. Over the past couple of years, I've really worked to get over that. I just get up there, and now I can. Everybody's like, "You're filming yourself." Totally, yeah, it's no big deal now. I trust my team. But it was amazing is that as they got up on that ladder, and they're sitting there, and they're sitting on that top step of the ladder, and they're shaking because of the heights, and they're sweating, and they're holding on, and they're like, "I can't do this," and everybody's like, "Come on, you can do this." It's amazing because it's like 9 out of 10 people every year, it's the same thing. 9 out of 10 people, when they look back at their team, they say, "The thing I'm going to let go of this year, I'm going to let go of my trust issues. I'm going to let go of my trust issues. I'm going to let go of the wounds and the hurts and the betrayals that I've gone through in my life, and I'm going to let those go, and I'm going to learn to trust again. And then they wrap their hands around their chest, and they fall back and let their team catch them. And we've got a pretty good track record so far. They've only dropped Pastor Richard one time, and that was an accident. But, you know, I was thinking about that. We have trust issues. We all have trust issues. Why do we have trust issues? Could it be that we live in a society that we know is self-seeking, that is self-serving? That when somebody comes and they seek to befriend us, or they come and they give us a promise, or they come and they offer something, the first thing in our mind, the first question we ask ourselves is, what do you want from me? What are you asking? What are you trying to get out of me? Could it be that we live in a society that's full of counterfeits? A society that of people and of products and of promises that promise to do something, but yet when we go into them and we buy into them and we give into them, we realize that they're not true, that they let us down. Could it be that we live in a society of fraud, of deceit, of people coming and saying one thing and grabbing another, just using us as a ladder to step higher on the life, on the trip of life, on the journey of life? You see, each and every one of us, we've been betrayed, we've been let down, we've had somebody, we've put our trust into somebody, made a commitment to somebody, or bought into a contract or somebody's guarantee. I mean, God forgive me, I spent so much time on my last week, I spent 20 minutes watching an infomercial about a pillow. And on this pillow infomercial, the guy literally promised this pillow would change my life. It would change the way I slept. And because it changed the way I slept, I would be healthier. I would lose weight because of this pillow. I wouldn't snore because of this pillow. My wife will love me more if I buy his pillow. And we're full of these promises. We're bombarded by promises. We're bombarded by enticements. Come over here and let me go come over here. And we've been in relationships with people where they've promised us lifelong love and commitment only to find that that didn't last. So what happens? We develop a trust issue. Our natural progression is to get into a defense mechanism, to build up the walls, because my mama taught me and I bet your mama taught you. The old statement, fool me once, shame on me. Fool me twice. No, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. I'm not going to let somebody hurt me. I'm not going to let somebody get to me. I've been wounded. I've been betrayed. You know how we say it? We say it like this. Trust isn't given. Trust is earned. And you've got to earn my trust. And you've got to learn to reach and jump over the hurdles that I've set and climb the walls that I've put, because I will not put myself in the position of being wounded by somebody I give my trust to. Again, we have trust issues. All of us, we've been betrayed. All of us, we've been let down. All of us, we've had our expectations not met when we thought they'd be met by somebody or something. So the question is, how can we trust? How can we get beyond this issue of trust? How can we look to our brother or to our sister? How can we look to God and say, God, I've got trust issues and I've got things that I got to get through in my life. How is it that we can get through these issues and begin to trust again? And I believe that the subject of where we're talking about today gives us that answer of our trust issues, looking at Hebrews 11 chapter. Hebrews 11 chapter is the culmination of everything that we've learned so far in the book of Hebrews, from chapter 1 all the way through chapter 10. Now we see, we've learned about Jesus, our high priest. We've learned about a better covenant. We've learned about God's promises. We've learned about God's faithfulness. And now we see the examples in the Bible of people who walked, who stepped out and began to live a life of faith as an example for you and I to step out of our comfort zone and to trust. And today we're going to look at verse number 11 of Hebrews 11 chapter. We're going to talk about Sarah. Now I'm going to go through the second half of the verse of 11 chapter, because Pastor Deborah brought a great message. She taught a great message back in the month of May on Mother's Day about Sarah. And if you remember some of the things where Sarah couldn't have a baby until she couldn't have a baby, if you remember that message. If you want to go back and refresh it, you can go online at rockchurch.com and listen to Mom's message. And Pastor Jessica taught about Moses' mother, and really powerful and impactful message. And today I want to focus on the second half of Hebrews, the 11th chapter, talking about this trust issue and how we can learn to deal with this. So Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 11, it says, by faith, Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed, Isaac. She bore a child when she was past the age, 90 years old, hallelujah, because she judged him faithful, who promised. There it is. The answer to our trust issues, right there in Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 11. Sarah, I'm going to tell you something that you already know. You don't need me to tell you what I'm going to tell you, but I'm going to tell you anyways. Sarah trusted in God, not men. Church, if you get anything today, if you get anything out of what we're talking about today, trust in God and stand on His promises. Trust in God and stand on His promises. That's what we're talking about today, is our trust is in God and we stand on His promises. And here it says in Hebrews 11 chapter that she trusted Him, that she counted Him faithful, that she judged or she reckoned Him, not Abraham, not her husband, not the people around her, not the remedies of what was going on. Sarah was in a place of impossibility. And it happened because she put her faith in God and not in man. You don't need me to tell you to trust in God. That's not even Christianity 101. That's like Christianity 000. It's the basis. It's the foundation. It's like the root of the foundation that you and I have got to trust in God. But you see, what happens is we have issues. We have trust issues. We've been wounded. We've been hurt. We've put our faith into somebody and they've let us down. They've been unreliable. I know in my own life, I can say I have let people down before. And I venture to say I'm probably not done letting people down in the course of my life. To put our trust into man is a risk. Always will be. Why? Because humanity, by nature, will let us down. But you see, she trusted in God. And what we must do is learn that we must trust in God, but not only that, to take what we have, to not take our wounds, to not take our hurdles, to not take our defense mechanism that we call a trust issue and apply it to God. Why? Because God is faithful. She judged God faithful. God is faithful to you. Therefore, you don't have to have a defense mechanism in trusting in God. Have you ever had a friend or somebody that you were in life with or in partnership with that was a flake? You know what I'm talking about? I like to say it like this. They're reliably unreliable. You can count on them to flake out on you. Now, whenever I tell stories, I always change the names and dates to protect the innocent. But I remember that there was a time when we were moving and we were packing up all of our stuff and we had called up some friends and asked like if you could move. You know, everybody hates that call. It's like the worst call. Everybody's trying to go on vacation when everybody else is moving because you don't want to be that guy. And I remember I was calling a friend of mine. They had a truck and I said, man, I'm moving on this day. Could you help me? Man, I'm going to be there. I'm going to help you. We got this. You don't need anybody else. Like, you got me. All right. I'm so excited about that. Then it came time to move. We started moving furniture. They didn't show up. We bought some pizza. They didn't show up. The sun started setting. They didn't show up. Called them a couple days later. Hey, man, did you know that we moved? You were supposed to help me. Oh, was that today? Oh, my bad. I'm so sorry for God. I didn't even. It's like, it's all right. Don't worry about it. I got it. I moved it all by myself. Thank you. You know what the best thing is? When somebody who flakes out on you asks you to help them. Isn't that just good? Don't you just love it? I mean, come on, indulge with me for a moment. Come on. You know that somebody's been flaking out on you and all of a sudden they need your help. And you got that little red guy on your shoulder over here. You got the little white guy over here with the halo. And you better be a good person. This is your time to show the love of Jesus. And this one's over here like, man, yeah, you tell them you should go and they just don't even show up. Give them a taste of their own medicine. You know what I'm talking about. It feels so good when they need your help. Because you start to think in your head, man, I'll be there. I'm gonna show them. I'm gonna give them a taste of their own medicine. I'm gonna tell them that I'm gonna show up, and then I'm not gonna show up. Or you know what? I'm gonna show up, and I'm gonna rub it in. I'm gonna just let them know. Well, I am a good friend. I am a true friend. I am a Christian. I show up. Even my yeses are my yeses, and my noes are my noes. It feels so good when somebody asks just to indulge in that. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Thank God. Our Father in heaven is not that way. Thank the Lord that God in heaven is not that way towards us. That His faithfulness, His consistency towards us is not reliant on our consistency and our faithfulness towards Him. That even when we are faithless, the Bible says in 2 Timothy, the 2nd chapter, the 13th verse, even while we are faithless, He is faithful. That God's faithfulness to us, to His people, is not reliant upon our being faithful back to God. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us as we're reading Sarah, that says that she's a matriarch. She's the mother of faith. that by faith she received strength to conceive. But the Bible tells us in Genesis that Sarah had some issues. Sarah had some doubts. When she heard that God's promise to Abraham was heritage, she said, I can't do this, so I'll do this how I think it should be done. Here's my maidservant, Hagar. Why don't you have her so that you can have a son, Abraham? And then when she hears God's promise to Abraham through the walls of the tent, the Bible says that she laughed. Now, many times people say, well, that was a laugh of faith. But if it was a laugh of faith, why did she deny it? And was she afraid of it? Why? Because Sarah had doubts in her heart. But yet here now we read Sarah's legacy. We don't see that Sarah was a doubter. We don't see that Sarah took things into her own hands. We read that Sarah was a woman of faith. Why? Because even while Sarah doubted, God was faithful to his promise. God was consistent to his word. And you see, church, you and I, we can stand, we can live, we can reach out, and we can trust God. Why? Because God is faithful. He's the same, like Becca was saying, today, yesterday, today, and forever. God does not change. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us in the book of James in the first chapter, it says that God is consistent. All things are from above, and it comes down from the Father of lights, whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. We don't have to worry about God abandoning us when we make mistakes. We don't have to worry about God leaving us high and dry because we flaked out on him. As a matter of fact, the course of God continues, and we don't have to worry about looking at his shadow changing course because we were unfaithful. When we were faithless, God was faithful. Consistent. Sarah judged him faithful. She could trust him. So church, don't take your defense mechanism of what's happened to you from men and apply that to God, because God is not a man that he should lie. So therefore, we've got to learn to let our defense mechanism against men go when it comes to trusting in God and dealing with our trust issues, because we can trust in God. I like that second part of Hebrews, the 11th chapter. It says, she counted him faithful who had promised. God's promises are concrete. They don't waver. They don't change. They're irrevocable. God cannot rescind his promise or take them back. They're not based upon what we do. His promises are based upon what he did. Which means, church, we can trust in God and we can stand on his promises. His promises, you can take them to the bank, like they would say, because God is trustworthy. Have you ever made a promise that you forgot? Have you ever told somebody that you'd be somewhere and then you forgot to go? Have you ever maybe made an appointment or a lunch date or something like that, and that person called you after about an hour and said, man, where are you at? I've been sitting waiting for you. I forgot. The Bible tells us that God is not slack in his promises. He does not treat his promise with lax. Oh, well, you know, I forgot I made that promise to so-and-so, and I forgot that, you know, oh man, I said that, but it's not that important right now. I got bigger fish to fry. The Bible says that the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some would consider slackness, but rather he is long-suffering for us. God knows the beginning from the end, the Alpha and the Omega. He sees all he is everywhere all at once. He knows what we need when we need it, and his promises are concrete in our lives. Therefore, we can stand on the promises of God. And the question is, why? How can we stand on God's promise? How do we know that God's promises are concrete? After all, they're written in a book. So does that mean that they're concrete because they're written in a book? No, God's promises are concrete because they're founded in Jesus. I love what Paul the Apostle says in 2 Corinthians, and I'm going to put it up on the New Living Translation. First chapter, he's talking to the church, and he's talking about the ministry of the Holy Spirit and help and comfort. And he says, man, we've been going through a hard time, and we've been facing tribulations, and now he begins to teach about Jesus and about God's promises. And I love that he says, for Jesus Christ, the Son of God, does not waver between yes and no. Well, I'm going to bless this person, and I don't know about that. Well, you know, you are a big mess up over here, so I'm gonna slack off on that. He says, he doesn't waver between yes and no. He is the one whom Silas, Timothy, and I preach to you. And as God's ultimate yes, he always does what he says. I love how it paints that picture. Jesus Christ is God's ultimate yes. God promised a redeemer. God promised a salvation. God promised healing. God promised redemption. God promised all these different things. And Jesus Christ is God's resounding yes. God put a stamp of approval on his promises by saying, I give for you Jesus. But I love what it says in the next verse. It's even better. It says, for all of God's promise have been fulfilled in Christ. Listen to this. With a resounding yes. All of God's promises have been fulfilled in Jesus Christ with a resounding yes. You see, Jesus is God standing on the top of a mountaintop shouting to you and I his promises. Yes, you need healing. Yes, you need salvation. Yes, you need fulfillment. Yes, you want life. Yes, all of his promises are a resounding yes because of Jesus Christ. I love that. And through Christ, our amen, which means yes, ascends to God for his glory. You see, God's promises aren't just something written on a page, church. They're not just something for you and I to take and say, well, that's cool, I'm gonna apply that and I hope it comes. God's promises aren't something written in a contract that we can look back and say, well, he wrote it on a parchment paper. God wrote his promises, the Bible says, on our hearts, and he sealed them with his stamp of approval, with his signature by the blood of Jesus Christ. Jesus is God's personal guarantee on his promises. He didn't just send the blood of bulls and goats like we learned in Hebrews. He didn't just make a blood covenant for you and I. He says, I will give to you my most valuable possession, my most valuable thing. I will give my son Jesus so that you and I can stand on the promises of God, that we might receive the Holy Spirit and God on the inside of us, and that we might live a life of promise, a life of blessing, a life of fulfillment, a life of purpose, a life of reason, because Jesus is God's resounding yes. God signed his promises with the blood of Jesus Christ on that cross. He's our satisfaction guarantee, 100% track record. I love this, how it tells us, what are the promises of God? The Bible tells us in Galatians in the third chapter, the Bible says that we receive the promises of Abraham. Through Christ Jesus, God has blessed the Gentiles. That's you and me, Gentiles, those who are outside of the blood of the promised people, with the same blessing that he promised to Abraham. I don't know about you, but I want blessing. I want my name to be great, not for popularity's sake, but I want people, like you said, and all the names, all the people of the world shall be blessed because of you. God says to Abraham, blessing, I'll bless you. I'll lead you and I'll guide you. I will make your name great. And in your name, all the nations of the world shall be blessed. God says, I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you. The blessing of Abraham, God says, is now a blessing upon you. Why? Because Jesus Christ, his promise was to Jesus. You see, a few verses later, in verse number 16, I don't have it on the overhead, the Bible says that God made a promise to Abraham saying concerning Abraham's seed. God said, in your seed, I will multiply. Now God says, and notice, the Bible says, notice he didn't say seeds as in Abraham and your descendants, because God wasn't talking about Abraham's descendant. God was talking about Jesus, the seed of Abraham, the seed of the promise. And God says, because of Jesus, I will bless the world. Because of this. And so see, the promise was to Abraham, but the promise was to Christ. And because God's promise, his covenant was to Jesus, now it's passed to you and I through the blood of Jesus Christ. 100% satisfaction guarantee. You don't need somebody to tell you to stand on the promises of God. Again, you already know that. But you need somebody to tell you to not take what you've had happen to you from people, to not take the frauds of this world, to not take the hardships and the pain and the trials and the deception that you've gone through and that you've endured. You've had people promise you. Many of you in this place sat across the aisle from somebody and they promised their life to you. They promised to love you for the rest of their lives, yet only to find that it disappeared. Only to find that it faded away. So you've been betrayed. You've had promises broken. But don't take the broken promises of humanity and apply them to God, because God's promises are sealed in the blood of Jesus Christ. They're his resounding amen to say, my promises will stand. My promises will stand. You've got trust issues with man, but trust in me and my promises will stand. You see, trust issues hold us back. They keep us from moving forward. Why? Because we've been wounded. Why? Because we've been damaged. Why? Because somebody's betrayed us. Why? Because I was vulnerable and you utilized that. So I'm cautious to proceed and I put my arm up and I don't want to move forward. And so trust issues hold us back. They keep us at arm's length from everybody around us. And we take trust issues and we apply them to God. When you talk to people who have left the church, people who were once in Christianity, now all of a sudden they're no longer serving God and they're no longer in the church, very rarely, if ever, do you see the root issue of somebody leaving God because of God. Most of the time you see people leaving God because of his people. Because man will always let us down. The people in your life, they'll let you down, and that's okay. They'll fail you. That's all right. Why? Because you'll fail people as well. You're human. I'm not done letting people down. Trusting in man with all of my eggs in the basket of trust in men is a gamble. It's a risk. But you see, I don't have to have that risk because my trust is in God. And when I trust in God, I don't have to have my defense mechanism up. I don't have to take the wounds that somebody's hurt me because God is not a man that he should lie. God is consistent. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I can stand on God's faithfulness and on his promises. Church, trust in God. Why? Because he's never failed, and he won't fail you. I love those insurance commercials. You know what I'm talking about? We have 93% satisfaction rating. I love those Larry H. Parker. Remember Larry H. Parker? I will fight for you, right? I've got a 99% success rating. I love how everybody likes to tout their 90% something. God does not have a 90% success rating. You see, God is the only one that has a 100% success rating. God has never failed, and he's not going to blow. Listen, he's not going to blow his 100% rating on you. You are not going to be that one time in all of humanity that God lets somebody down. Why? Because he is faithful. He is trustworthy. He is solid. He is unchanging. His promises are never ending. They keep going because they're God's resounding yes in Jesus. Trust in God. He's never failed, and he'll never fail you. And so we stand here with our trust issues. We look at the end of our physical ability, like Sarah, 90 years old, unable to have a baby. And we're at the end of our rope, holding on with one hand, ready to let go. And we say to God, God, I will trust you with my life. God, I will trust you with my children. God, I will trust you with my job. God, I will trust you with my finances. God, I will trust you with my happiness. God, I will trust you with my fulfillment. God, I will trust you in everything I have. My trust will not be on the left or on the right, on what they said or what they did. My trust is based on you. And there we are, holding on to the end of our rope, physically able. And the hand of Christ reaches down and grabs us and pulls us out of the bottom of the barrel, out of the bottom of our rope, and begins to pull us and lift us up. Now we are no longer at the bottom of our physical ability, but God has brought us from where we were able to go physically to now supernaturally. Sarah, 90 years old, impossible to have a baby. The arm of God came and lifted her up off the bottom of a rope and said, no, my promises for you are yes and amen. And he brought her from the physical to the supernatural. That's why the Bible says, do not grow weary while doing good. For in due season, you will reap if you do not lose heart. Church, our trust issues are we take what's happened to us by men and we give it to God and we say, God, you'll do this to us too. But the truth of the matter is God will never fail. He has not failed and he will not fail. And we can put our trust into God. I love what Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse number 23 says. I'll put it in the message because it's so cool. It says, keep a firm grip on the promises that keep us going. He always keeps his word. He always keeps his word. God is faithful. He's never failed. He won't fail you. And so when we talk about dealing with our trust issues, how do we deal with our trust issues? We deal with our trust issues by not placing our trust in the men around us. Yes, it's good to have a relationship. And yes, I trust my wife and I trust my friends and I trust my business partners, but my trust is not based on them. My trust is based on God because God will never fail me. He'll never disappoint. He'll never let me go. His words are solid. His words are true. His promises are everlasting and God's resounding yes and signed and sealed and delivered by the blood of Jesus Christ. So therefore, all of my trust, all of my eggs are in the basket of God. And that puts my life into perspective so that when something happens over here, something happens over there, I can say my trust is in God and I stand on his promises. My trust is in God, and I stand in His promises. And the perspective of my life begins to open. And I realize that men will fail me, and I will fail men. But my trust is in God, and I stand on His promises. Church, dealing with our trust issues means we give our trust to God, and we base our trust on God, and everything else in our life begins to come into place. Perspective begins to lay everything out, and we see the horizon in front of us, and we realize that when God promises us life here on earth, that we will live a life of fulfillment and understanding and blessing, because the blessings of Abraham are passed to us because of God's resounding amen. God says, I will bless you. God says, and in your name, all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. He says, I will bless those who bless you. I will curse those who curse you. It's not just about you. It's about your family. It's about your children. It's about your legacy. Because you see, the promise of Abraham goes on for generations and generations and generations to come. And what a story and a testimony it is for the generations to come to look at their previous generations, you and me, and to say, I learned because they trusted in God. And they stood on His promises. And God did not fail them. God will not fail me. Church, trust in God. Stand on His promises. Let's pray together. Father, we just come before you. And Lord, we lift you up. We lift up the name of Jesus, the resounding yes of your promises. First and foremost, Father, thank you for your son, Jesus, that died on a cross, that spilled his blood so that we could be partakers of the inheritance, that we could be heirs of the promise of the blessing of God. Lord, we thank you for that. Lord, I pray that as this week, as we spend time, as we go out of this auditorium to be the sanctuary of the living God outside in this world, Lord, I pray as we spend our time seeking after you, Lord, this week, that your Holy Spirit would minister to us, each and every one of us, your love, your kindness, your long-suffering for us, Lord, that we would know that you are trustworthy, Lord, that we can put our life into your hands, Lord, that we can trust you and we can take a step of faith in learning and leaning on you in everything that we do. Father, I thank you that you would speak to each and every person that's in this room today of your love towards them, of your desire towards them, of your will towards them, and Lord, of your direction in their life. Lord, as we seek after you, I pray, Lord, that you would draw near to us, that we would know that you are closer to us than ever before. And Lord, I thank you that we can trust in you. Lord, there are many in this place that have had such deep wounds with trust, some betrayals that we couldn't even imagine. Hardships that we couldn't even begin to talk about, Lord. And I pray as they hold on to those, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would begin to comfort them in their hardships, in their betrayals, and then you would begin to work in their hearts to soften their hearts, that they would fix their eyes on you and focus on you, the author and the finisher of our faith, the captain of our salvation. And Lord, to you be the praise and the glory and the honor in Jesus' mighty name. We all said, amen. Amen. Did you guys get something out of the word of the Lord today? Praise God. So listen, before we leave today, I want to do something very important. I see, I don't know everybody in this place. I don't know where you stand. And there's many people here that are here for the very first time, and some of you I just don't know. And I wish I could. I wish I knew y'all, but it would be a travesty. It would be a terrible thing for us to leave under the assumption that everybody in this house is okay and right with God. When in the truth of the reality is that there's those of us in this place or those of you in this place that may not be in the right position with God. And the Bible says that we ought to examine ourselves from time to time. So I want to ask you, first and foremost, do me a favor. Just remain seated. Don't get up. Don't leave. What I'm about to ask you is so important. Your eternal destiny is at stake. Just think for a moment. Listen to what I have to say. The question I want you to answer in your heart, in your mind, is this. If you were to leave today and you were to die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? I know that's a difficult question sometimes to think about. Somebody told me that people under the age of 25 can't even physically comprehend the reality that they're going to die one of these days. But just think about it for a moment. If you were to die right now, how you stand with God, your position with God, what would end up of your eternal life? And how you answer that question or how you come to your conclusion has a lot to say about your position with God. So let's examine that. Let's go over that and let's compare it to what the Bible says. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can hope your way into heaven? I've talked to a lot of people, and the answer I often get is, man, I sure hope I'm going to go to heaven. That's where I want to go. Did you know that nowhere can you find that you can think, that you can hope, that you can want or desire your way into heaven, and that's going to get you into heaven? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents told you growing up that you were a Christian, because you sit in church and you hear the pastor preach, because you were baptized as a baby that you're going to get into heaven. You can't find that anywhere in God's word, those type of things. That when the census came knocking on your door a couple of years ago, that when you checked on the checkbox, you marked Christian. Did you know that 78% of America checked that Christian check mark? But you see, we can see clearly, based on the works, based on the outward appearance of what people are doing, that 78% of America is not truly following and seeking after God. Why? Because it's not about a title. It's not about a position. It's not about a name that we give ourselves. We love to label ourselves in this country. But do you know that God's not looking for a system of default classifications? He's not looking for a spreadsheet of your beliefs that, well, because you're not a Buddhist or a Hindu or a Muslim, that must mean that you're a Christian. Your parents told you you were a Christian, so that makes it good enough for you to get into heaven. You'll never find that in the Word of God. Nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you're involved in church, you carried the pastor's Bible, you serve in the children's ministry, you sing in the choir. Nowhere does it say that because you've even got a card in your wallet that says you're a member of a church that you're going to get to heaven. You cannot find that in the Word of God. So often what happens is we think that if I'm a good person, I try to do the best I can, I help out my fellow human beings, I give to charitable organizations every once in a while, and I even stand for social justice, I'm happy for things that are going on. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person that you're going to get into heaven? Yet so many people in America and so many people around the world think that all I have to do is be a good person to get into heaven. But the Bible tells us that our good deeds according to God's righteousness are like filthy rags. You see, nothing you could do, nothing that I could do would ever make us good enough. Why? Because the Bible says that we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. God's standard for entrance is perfection, and we all have come short of His standard. So what do we do? We can't do it your way. Can't do it some well-meaning church committee or author's way. Listen, you can't buy your way into heaven or earn your way into heaven or work your way into heaven. The only way you and I can get into God's heaven is God's way, and Jesus Christ is that way. Jesus says that He is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one goes to the Father except through Him. So today I want to give you the opportunity to do it God's way. In the book of John, Jesus is speaking to a religious leader, a man by the name of Nicodemus, a man who memorized Scripture, a man who did all the right things, who fed the poor, did all the right things, and said all the right things. And Jesus says these words to Nicodemus. He says, in order to see the kingdom of God, you must be born again. There it is, God's way. What does that mean to be born again? Well, it's not what you think of it. It's not what Hollywood or society or the internet's made it out to be, weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity. Born again from the beginning of God's word to the end of God's word has always meant the same thing in God's heart. Here it is. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through His Son, Jesus Christ. Let me show it to you in the Bible. The book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to the church, to you and I, to us. It's His final plea to us to stop living life our way. He says these words, and I'll paraphrase them. He says, you think that you're clothed, you think that you're full, you think that you're wealthy, but you don't realize that you're naked and destitute and lonely. He says, oh, I wish that you would come to me. He comes back and he says, I'm going to come back, I'm going to return, and when I return, I'd rather find that you're hot, or I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. And it's a shocking statement out of the mouth of Jesus. It's crude, it's rude. It's designed to get our attention. It's His final plea to the church to stop living life our way. Start living it His way. What does it mean to be lukewarm? Lukewarm simply means, in terms of your relationship, that you've got your ups and your downs. You've got your ins and your outs, your occasional church attendance, your token prayer, doing some of your own thing. You come to church on Sunday and you play the part really good. But then Monday through Saturday, you're living for you. And then the cycle repeats. Listen, I love you enough, I respect you enough, I honor you enough today to not tell you what you want to hear, but to tell you what you need to hear, that you're not going to make it based on your own devices. You're not going to make it based on your wishes or your hopes or your desires, based on your religious affiliation, based on your traditional rituals. The only way you and I are going to make it into God's heaven is God's way, and Jesus is that way. And today I want to give you the opportunity to ensure your place with God in heaven forever, leaving hell behind. You see, the Bible tells us that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. Like any gift, it's a free will choice. When somebody gives you a gift, you've got a choice to accept it or to return it or reject it. It's your choice. You see, God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force His way or make His way. And sometimes people say, man, if God wants me, He'll take me. God says, I've done everything I could by giving for you and for me, Jesus Christ, to die a beaten, bloody mess on the cross for our sin and our shame. And in return, He says, I want your heart. I want your life. Jesus says these words. He says that if you confess Him before men, He will confess you before His Father. Today, I want to give you that opportunity. He says, all going further, He says, but if you deny me, I'll deny you. The decision's totally and wholly yours today, and I want to give you that opportunity. Here's what I'm going to do. In just a moment, I'll count to three. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three, and I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. And when I do, I'm going to give you the opportunity. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, you know what? I want to give God my heart. I want to give God my life. I want to make the decision today to follow Jesus. I want to make the decision today to surrender my life to Jesus Christ and to choose heaven. See, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. You say, ah, Pastor Luke, if I raise my hand, I might be embarrassed. I'm not going to embarrass you. But even if you were embarrassed, wouldn't it be better to spend a moment of embarrassment here in a warm and welcome, loving place in the church that supports you and wants to see you do this than to live an eternity in hell because you couldn't go forward for God? It's not a game. It's not a joke. It even goes so far as to say it's not even about what happens when you die. That's so important to you and I. But Jesus says these words. He says, I have come to give you life that you might have it more abundantly. There are those of you in this place today that you've been trying to fill your life with money, with relationships, with friends, and with positions and titles to find fulfillment, but no matter how much you try to fill your life, you always find that there's an emptiness and a void on the inside of you. Jesus says, oh, I wish that you would come to me. I wish that you would fill the emptiness on the inside of you that you cannot fill with things of this world and fill it with me. You see, the hole that's on the inside of us, that emptiness, is a God-sized hole designed to be filled by the love of Jesus Christ. And it starts by accepting that gift, by making that decision. And that's what you're doing, is you're making a decision by raising your hand. I'll see your hand and I'll acknowledge it. Go forward together from there. Who should raise your hands if you've never given him your heart, you've never given him your life? If that's you in just a moment, get ready. Pop your hand up, I'll see it and I'll acknowledge it. If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child or in the youth group. Maybe you went to one of Greg Laurie's Harvest Crusades and you prayed that prayer, but you've never really followed through with it, or prayed a prayer on TV, but you've never really followed through with it. Listen, if that's you in this place today, I want to encourage you. Today is the day of your salvation. Go ahead and pop your hand up in just a moment. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God, saying, listen, it's time to stop playing games. It's not a game. It's not he who collects the most points wins. It's about Jesus and giving your heart and your life to Jesus Christ. And it starts by making that decision and that commitment today. I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. All across this auditorium, from side to side, from front to back, wherever you're at, if that's you in this place in a moment, get ready. Pop your hand up. Hands are already going up. I see you. I'll get them in just a moment. Whether you're at home right now watching on the live stream, if that's you, you can minimize your browser. There's a little browser. There's a little blue button you can push. It says, know God, and somebody will pray with you right there on your screen. The decision is yours today. You've had doctors and dentist appointments and the divine appointment today. Between you and God, you're here for this reason, to give God your heart. Give God your life. Hands are already going up. It's time for you to make that choice. I'm going to count to three, and when I do, if that's you, get ready. Pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. Put it right back down, and we'll follow through together from there. You ready? Here we go. From the front row to the back row. Here we go. Ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11. I see you right there. 12, I got you back there in the back. 13, I see you back there. 14, I see you. 15, I got you right up here in the front. 15 wise people, I got you right there in the back. I got him. 15 wise people. 16, I see you. 17, I got you back there in the back as well. Ushers are pointing in that direction. 18 back there. I see that hand in the family room. 19. Anybody else in this place? I see you right there in front of the family room. Say, man, I wonder if I should. You see, the Bible says that it's the goodness of God that draws men through repentance. God's speaking to you. It's time for you to answer. Stop doing life your way. Start doing it God's way. It starts by making that decision. Anybody else in this place today? Say, man, I wonder if I should. It's your time. It's your moment. Anybody else today? I'm going to close it up. Well, let's give God a great big praise for 19 or so wise people. Hallelujah. All right, here's what we're going to do. For all 19, number 20, that you raised your hands, maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you know you should have. The Spirit of God speaking to you, and you're thinking in your heart, man, I missed it. No, you didn't miss it. It's not too late. If you raised your hand, you said, I'm making a decision. You know this. This is logic. Every decision requires action for something to happen. It's time for you to take action on that decision, and we're going to do that together. We're going to follow through together. So if you raised your hands, or maybe you should have raised your hand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend, if you've got family members, say, hey, come with me. Or if somebody next to you raised their hand, or your friend or a family member, say, hey, come on, I'll go with you. Let's go together. And get out of your seat, get into the aisle, and come meet me right here at this altar. We're going to change destinies together right here, right now. So let's all stand. Elijah's going to sing a song. Please don't anybody leave as they come. But if that's you in this place, come meet me right here, right now. Let's change destinies together.
Just as you are, oh, and hear the Spirit call.
That's you, you come. You can come.
Just
out of the balconies, out of the back, wherever you're at. You come.
Come and see. Come and
just they're still coming. We'll wait for you guys. You're worth it. It's your moment. You come.
And you'll never thirst again.
Praise God. You guys came. Listen, maybe you've never had somebody tell you, but somebody needs to tell you today. Good job. You're doing a good job. Making the best decision you can possibly make. Good on you. Here's what I want to do. First, I want to tell you something. You can wipe the frown upside down. Why? Because you're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday celebration. Today's the first day of the rest of your life. You're going to get born again. Good job. Party going on in heaven for you. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is a really cool guy. Here's what he's going to do. He's going to take you guys just right over there. Nothing weird goes on, I promise. All right, here's what he's going to do. I'll tell you what he's going to do. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by inviting Jesus to come and be the Lord and Savior of your life. What does that mean, Lord and Savior? We don't talk like that very much anymore. How about this? How about to be the leader of your life? You're going to invite him to be the leader of your life. Second thing he's going to do is we don't want you to leave here empty-handed. You're going to walk out of this place. You say, what do I do? We're going to point you in the right direction and give you some free information, some real easy reading just to help get you set on the right foot. The third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. He's going to introduce you to some friends. You'll meet him today that will meet with you right before church or right after church. They'll buy you a cup of coffee on them, on the church. Man, they'll get, you don't got to do nothing but show up. They'll teach you some things about the Word of God for just a couple of weeks. You're not joining some big, long program. You're just meeting with a friend. Somebody that will teach you some things about the Word of God to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything that God has for you. So if you guys would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my friend, Pastor Joel. Congratulations. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me. And then he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.